There's only one time that I've truly regretted being recognized in public. The dude is like, yeah, sorry, dude, we're all booked up. Your reservation was for last night, not for tonight. And the guy makes the mistake of saying, well, I could have given you a room, but I don't like your attitude, so now I won't. And so right in front of him, I dial 888, fuck you. I'm standing in front of so-and-so, and he said that there was a clerical mistake, and he could have given me a room, but he didn't like my face, so he's not giving me a room. And then they're like, hold on, let me call him. And then I hear them put me on hold music, and 2 seconds later, I hear the hotel phone ring. And he picks up the phone, he's like, hello. Yes, well, he was, I didn't like the way he... Yes. And he hangs up and he goes, I will be able to accommodate you with a room. In my asshole lizard brain, I think like, hey, fuck you, guy. I got a room, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then my phone goes, ba-de-dip, and I look and it's a tweet where somebody says, Ashwood, yeah, man, that guy was an asshole. And I was like, wait, what? This is the one time that I very loudly and very extremely totally played the total asshole card because I thought nobody was watching and it turned out everybody was watching. So it was a bummer. That was shockingly close to exactly what it looked like, but that means it is Tuesday night and it has got to be go time for Night Attack, bringing you the best of the worst of the internet ever since 1776. Hello, beautiful folks. I'm Brian Brushwood, live in Austin, Texas. Joined by my BFF and OK, it's JRY. What's up, Justin Robert Young?
Oh, man. You ready? Y'all ready for this?
Is that the 21st century version of Deep in the Heart of Texas? Like, which do you think you'll get more people jumping in on? Shouting, the stars at night are big and bright, and then just leaving it out there.
I told this story on the show, right?
No.
About me coming into Cleveland?
No.
I was coming into Cleveland for the Republican National Convention, and I had to connect through Houston. But I was on a red eye, so I was flying from San Francisco to Cleveland so I could get there with a little bit more time during the day. And, you know, like, you know that whenever you're doing that, you're, like, sleeping is at a premium, right? You're trying
sure.
to sleep every inch of that flight. And I land in Cleveland, and I am awoken to what I assume are either very excited Texans or Texas delegates there for the convention who break out into a total unironic, the stars at night are big and bright, deep in the heart of Texas. Clap,
I mean,
clap.
Well, okay, now, first of all, which makes more sense? To sing it in Texas, where everybody already knows this, it's a fact, or to explain it to all those benighted jackasses in Ohio? It seems like it only makes sense that you got to explain to all the people that the stars at night are big and bright, deep in the heart of Texas.
Well, I mean, listen, so is my sleep debt was deep in the heart of Texas, and I was hoping to replenish it by the time I got to Ohio. Not to be unceremoniously woken up by a bunch of jacknapes, but no, it was definitely the first time that I mean, Texans love Texas. Like that is an uncommon among state pride throughout the rest of the 49 states and how much Texans love Texas. But that was certainly a very big part of it.
You know, I'm reminded of a time when I was getting very little sleep. I was a young mother.
To Ira Glass with This yeah. American Life. Go ahead.
Bonnie Brushwood, of course, joining us. Welcome to the show, Bonnie.
Hey. I was a young mother, nursing baby a couple times a night. I needed my sleep. And a young Justin Robert Young enters our house with Brian Brushwood and... laughs and laughs and laughs. You guys kept me up all night long.
I love it. That moment she drops the facade. It's just like, you fuckers, I didn't get any sleep.
I didn't get any sleep.
That was that fateful night in Orlando, Florida.
Yeah,
that fateful night.
Hey man, so how long you been back home? Have you recentered yourself after all the travel extravaganza?
Well, you know, the problem with the travel this time was that I've certainly traveled more. I don't know if I've ever traveled so much where I'm staying places too long. Like, the problem is just that I was getting on a schedule in places that weren't my house.
Yeah.
And then going back and forth and back and forth and, like, staying in places for, like, at a minimum of 4 days, if not a week. Like, that's the real pain in the ass. Like, that sucks.
Wait a minute. So the part you resent is the fact that you stayed in any one place long enough to fall in love with it?
Well, just to not have it be a total chaos. I like the chaos. If I'm on the road, I want to be going 14 different places. I want to constantly be driving different places. I want to constantly be flying back and forth. That's what I have the most practice at the very least, right?
Yeah, no, I totally agree with that. Like when I was touring super heavy, it was like everything existed in 4 hour blocks, right? It's like 4 hours from now, I have to be on stage. 4 hours from now, I have to be asleep. 4 hours from now, I have to be at the airport, and just repeat over and over and over again.
And like, it sucks because at that point, all you want is like the extra day to hang out with friends or meet up with people, especially since we've been doing the podcast. It's like you always have the opportunity to do a meetup or something like that, which is always fun. But yeah, no, this was like all the work of doing a super crazy hard schedule, but then also being able to reset, you know, your internal sort of clock to someplace else and then come back. So now been back for about a week and maybe a little less than a week. And It's been good. Yeah. Just trying to
you don't have that travel hangover, because like I always think I get home and I'm like, oh man, I'm just gonna sleep for a million years and it's gonna be so great. And then you sleep for 20 minutes and you're like, this is boring. My life's over. Why am I not on the road doing important stuff like I was 20 minutes ago?
Oh no. Well, yeah, you gotta eliminate this like thought about sleep. Like, sleep is definitely just a problem, and it needs to be eliminated from modern society.
It's a weird disease where your body becomes arrested for up to 8 hours at a time.
Let's practice death.
Death like, practice.
Yeah, whatever. That's freaky. I don't like that, man. I don't trust it. No, I mean it's all right. It was you know. There's obviously just a schedule that you have to hit, you know, when you're doing what we're doing, which is like independent podcasting and you know, keep grinding and you got new
kicking
stuff
those
in the
asses. By the way, so wait, are you home until DragonCon?
Home until DragonCon, yeah.
And you already have hotel worked out. I still have to work out hotel. Hey, Bryce, funny story. I have to work out hotel for DragonCon.
Weird. I've never heard that story before.
Yeah, well, yeah.
And you're wondering why I'm not going to DragonCon. Well, this
I mean,
year.
If you were going, I would have had this worked out months in advance.
Sure.
Well, you know, you actually kind of still have to work out hotel for CreateCon.
Oh, yeah. By the way, I'm still waiting on my invoice. Just let me know. Send me the bill.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry.
Hey, man, I
can't
divide. My invoice
was settled when a drunken Brian Brushwood said, whatever. I'm not going to go down to the front office. I'm just going to pay you $400.
Oh, well, I mean, if you want to settle on that being the magic number, I'll do that. But I figured I actually owed more when you tallied it all up and divided it by two.
Whatever. I mean, $400 is fine.
All right, hold on. Live on the air, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, here we go. There we go. Let's sacrifice chunks of the show. Listen, Dragon Con's going to be great. We do have some announcements, though, about Dragon Con.
You want to jump in on that? Where do you want to go? We got a bunch of different things to cover.
Let's start with the bad news. We do have bad news.
Ah. Yeah, real bad news.
Really? Every Dragon Con we've done has featured myself, Brian Brushwood,
mm-hmm.
and
Tom Merritt and Veronica Belmont, the podcasting firm of Belmont, Merritt, Brushwood, and Young.
That will not be happening this
year.
Yeah,
that's the sound of a thousand, hold on, eat hotel poop. There we go, and $400 is sent. hopefully nobody's going to like cancel their planned trip to Atlanta, right? We have plenty of awesome things happening.
Well, I mean, I guess here's my question to you, Brian. Are we officially on the hunt for new Dragon Con best friends?
Oh, Justin, that's dark.
See, I didn't even make the list.
I mean,
like,
listen,
that really
they're
hurts
not
my feelings.
Like, well,
that's dark. Wait, what?
I didn't make the list. You guys always talk about Merritt, y'all don't even put a chair for me when you do the panel.
Wait, what?
And I'm like, you know, fuck you guys.
Oh, jeez.
Somebody took the belt.
You You trick me. You tricked
I didn't
me.
Trick you.
No one said anything.
Unless it was a 4-year con of being rude to you at DragonCon.
You guys do this loosey-goosey pre-show, and then I'm all like, all right, I'm ready to cuss on the mic tonight. Okay.
No, anyways. I mean, Bonnie, anytime that you're there, you're a part of the show.
You didn't put a chair out for me.
That's a very specific problem that she has.
All right, so here we go. Let's go ahead and build up the hype. Build up the hype for DragonCon.
There will be an empty chair there in memory of Bonnie at every panel I appear on. That's my pledge.
How much will it cost to get a chair bronzed for her?
And
you can pretend
at every panel, I'm not only going to leave the chair out, right, but also at some point I'm just going to start laughing and tell the chair that was a great joke.
Well, people are pointing out that technically the chair was there. It was just invisible. We just wanted to be right for you.
Aw, thanks, guys.
So wait, you think it's too callous for us to be on the hunt for new DragonCon best friends?
Who, me?
Yeah.
Oh, no. They're not going to.
No, no, Brian. Brian was like, wow, that's dark.
I mean, just, you know, look, Tom and Veronica have been, they've defined our experience, right? It's to go and be there with. Tom and Veronica were hip to DragonCon before we were, and it was their party that we were always crashing. And now they're not there. I mean, we don't have to turn around and have our next breath be all like, yo, who else has a beard? Who else hosts Vaginal Fantasy? Get on over here.
Well, I mean, but also look like that panel is normally something a little bit bigger, right? We like to do bigger stuff for the live show. I don't know. You don't think that we should,
other
special guests?
Wow, that's a really good point. You're talking about the live Night Attack show. That is.
Yeah. Wait, is Mikey going?
Oh, can we get Mikey Newman?
I can ask if he's going. I don't know. He might be.
That doesn't seem he's more in the gaming con more of the PAX crowd.
Do you think we could against his will steal Scott Johnson out like as a surprise guest?
We would literally have to tranquilize Scott Johnson.
I don't know. I yes to that, but also if we set it up as a secret heist that he never told anyone and he just got to show up for one panel and surprise everyone and then leave, I almost think he would go for that just on principle.
I don't. I genuinely do not think he would do it. Listen, he's a bit of a finicky fellow, like especially when it comes to crowds, especially when it comes to flying. Like he's not made of our stock where it's just like, hey, whatever, red eye to who gives a fart. Yeah, man, let's go.
Waffleophagus points out he didn't come out for your wedding, so something tells me he's not going to come out for the panel.
There was that part where I had like a 3-hour conversation with him about why how bad he felt that he wasn't coming out to the wedding.
people are saying George Robb and Scott Sigler. Scott Sigler's a slam dunk if he's going to be there, right?
If Sigler's there, I mean, I think he's always some part of the show. Like, yes. he's definitely on the panel no matter what. Yeah.
Do we know if
that leaves one more? I don't think we got to settle this right now. I think that this is just out in the ether, right? Maybe it's always going to be a mystery slot, but we will fill it with somebody.
Yeah, that works for me. Right now, though, there's only one empty slot in my heart. And it's filled by beautiful, sweet, sweet music created by your friend of mine, Stephen Cogswell, which, by the way, I don't think so quietly behind the scenes. Are we allowed to say who's working on the album? Or is that all secret?
I don't think it's secret. No.
Okay. Well, then let me look up the email for because we put out the words to the ether that we wanted the album to happen, to not be a faint, you know, Chinese democracy mystery. And what? Angela Castaneda wrote us and is spearheading this. I believe she said that she has like an audio engineer who's taking.
Yeah. So I've met with her a couple of times. She's always been so supportive of so many things. She actually got when Ashley and I were doing our Dream War podcast leading up to the wedding and we had our public gift registry, she bought the second half of our gigantic bird a mansion.
Oh wow.
Yeah, no, she's been so supportive. But she works out in production in Las Vegas and she's dedicated, I guess, or like helped broker a deal with another one of her staff that's also a fan of the show, and they are currently or have already poured through all of our loose ass tracks over the past 2 years now, 2.5 years.
Okay, so I don't want to give too many details away, and I don't think I'm talking out of school, but like we've never seen this level of organization for any of the albums beforehand. There's so I'm looking at, hold on, I'm trying to load up. Oh, there it is. Okay, so
we've got they went through and listened to.
I think
to,
you could show, you could put this on screen.
Yeah, I'm just trying
right?
to make sure there aren't any special links on here. They went through and categorized every session, every record date, all of the data on it, as well as how much
as well as
it
track
needs.
Comments. Like
it's not racist.
Dixon Balls, nude election. President Jacket in the Oval Office.
There's one that just bothered me. I don't remember
which
this
one.
There's a prostitute Bonnie.
50, oh no, you know that one. We were talking about the Middle Ages and how you were going to be a prostitute.
This one, all caps, just says "Deal or No Deal" style drink shot of diarrhea. Oh,
there's one comment that just says "So funny." Yeah, no, fuck you.
Yeah!
Oh, God damn it. Shit. Anyway, it's going to be real good.
We had thought that we were going to have to at some point talk to each other about what we're gonna do, but we could do it on air if you want. What are you thinking for when we want to drop this hot new comedy album?
Dude, the question is whether or not we want to try to blow up the Death Star again. It's been a while since we dropped an album. I would really like to shoot to make it number one again. The reason I was talking about the album is because I don't think we talked to Angela about the fact that Stephen Cogswell's cool with putting all his music on. I think Stephen Cogswell should be the defining musical voice of this album.
I mean, I almost feel like the Cogswell stuff, I feel like that can be kind of chat realm or patron nominations, right? Of like, because we're gonna have to have the best of the best.
Yeah,
like, prolific.
Yeah,
like, that dude's got 4 hours. He's got his own album. He's got his own double album just in stuff he's done for our show.
Yeah, no. Absolutely. In fact, actually, if you guys watching live want to organize some kind of ranking system, some kind of a straw poll deal for that, then that would be awesome. But dude, no, I'm stupid excited, but not as excited as I am for the new Stephen Cogswell joint, which I want to hear right now.
Give me
smooth. Yeah, smooth. I'll have a rogue's brew for two. There's a man with a mug saying, "Hey, fuck you," and he drinks all his beer saying, "Hey, fuck you," and he goes to sleep screaming, "Hey, fuck you." His wife punches him in the face. Yeah! Oh! There's a man at the mug screaming, "Hey, fuck you!" Hey.
I'm feeling it, dude! Let's set this ship on fire!
Yeah, into the eyes of understanding.
Hey,
look at me.
The rest of our lives is a total fantasy, and this is the only real moment that exists.
There's a from the man, and he's across from you, screaming, "Hey, fuck you!"
Grandpappy said, he said, "A man ain't worth nothing that can't make no brown ale for himself."
Hey, Brian, we can't dance to nothing.
Fuck you!
There we go. That's the pub song.
It's pretty good. I do love the cover art in which I'm clearly drinking from a bottle in which your severed head rests ghost-like.
I think you're thinking that it's my ghost. Yes. That, like, this is the memory of me.
And then he's glowing.
There's a reflection right beneath your beard that makes it look like you're wearing a priest's collar as well. It's
yeah,
as though you're a Jesuit priest.
Very, like, a cyberpunk dyed beard. With, like, yeah, you know, I mean, I didn't get a chance to reply to the Cogs about this, but like, I just kind of want him. I want to know from him how he feels that he's going to have 400 plus people singing along to that song
at DragonCon.
At DragonCon. Because yes. that's a virtual certainty. We do not go in front of a hotter crowd all year, but for DragonCon.
Speaking of which, do we have a musical guest lined up?
We don't.
I almost was able to get Professor Elemental last year. Let me try that again. I'll reach out to him again.
Was he there?
He was. Either last year or the year before, he did a concert, but he had a nutty schedule and wasn't able to do it. But if we could get him out to do just one thing at the opening, that would be amazing.
Oh, God. I mean, anything we could do.
Scotty Moe says GMC faux show. Do you think we can get him out?
He was like, he was definitely into working with us when I emailed him. But he was also very like, I don't think he wanted to do like a show, like just like a spot. Like he wanted to do something crazy.
Crazier than his actual music.
I mean, listen, I can read you the exact words.
All right.
That he that he sent me. Let me hear. Phil for a second. And I'll. Hey, look, I got $400.
Yeah. What's the note on that say?
I don't know. Hold on. Hey, you can't. I'm trying
I'll
to
tell
ask
you what
to
it
Phil.
Says.
I'm
it says eat hotel poop. So there's that. Hey, look, I got $400. Go on.
Here we go. All right.
People in the chat are remembering some of our previous musical guests, including the appearance from Old John Smokey, singing about TSA, taking his spoons away.
So here we go. I guess initially, and this was, man, about a year ago, a little under a year ago. He emailed us because I guess he was watching. This might have been when we were trying to blow up his little
pants
with
Tay Allen, yeah.
When Tay Allen, I mean, geez, talk about direct marketing, Tay. Jesus, that story.
Wait, what?
She was fairly aggressive.
Oh,
with the GMC for sure, as I remember. I don't know. Maybe memory's foggy on it, but. He just said, hey, I ain't personally much for interviews, but if y'all up for random S like laser tag in a swimming pool, hit me up.
Wow.
All right. Can we figure out some way to actually make laser tag in a swimming pool happen? Just for no other reason. Like, he's in Atlanta, right?
He's not.
In Detroit.
He's in Detroit. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. All right.
In the D. Yeah. I mean, listen, there's... Who knows? I mean, listen, this is the earliest we've ever planned anything for DragonCon.
Yeah, dude, it's like 3 whole weeks away, man.
The world is our
oyster. Do you realize how many minutes are in 3 weeks? Like 100? We got like over 100 minutes.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
Well, I'll tell you what, especially with the album coming up, one of the big things that we wanted to do with our Patreon was to make sure that we rewarded our patrons with early tracks of the albums, although you guys have probably already gotten a lot of it via our
mixtapes.
Our mixtapes. You have not gotten all of it, and that is what you will get if you support us. So head on over to patreon.com/nightattack and make sure that you, if you are inclined, kick us in a little coin. You indeed will get early tracks from the album. Help us figure out the order of where stuff should go. It is all up to you guys.
Justin.
Patreon.com.
Justin, we're at 1,595 patrons. I want to goose that up. Let's get five more of y'all. Take that plunge.
Then we're in the 1,600s?
Yeah. Dude, I want to get closer to Canterbury Tales.
We're riding up on your butthole, Chaucer. Yo, Chaucer. Chaucer, I could smell your farts. We're so close to your butthole. Yeah, what's up, Chaucer?
All right, hold on, time out. While we're talking about Chaucer.
Yeah. You mean Chaucer's butthole? Because I can paint it by my memory. I'm so close.
So there's that random button on the porn site that just goes random, and it brought up the word vintage, and there was something that had 7% approval ratings. And I was like, what vintage Pardo has 7%? Because it seems to me like even when Pardo's bad, it delivers on certain aspects, right?
The cave painting? How retro?
Yes, exactly. How far back are we going? And I click on it. It's an hour and a half long video. It's a complete film video of the Canterbury Tales. Only it's got people pausing to do it between each tale. And they're actually like acting and they're doing it in the hay and they're doing it.
All right. Somebody find that. Somebody find that. Let's get the link. We need to at least, we don't need to watch it, but we need to.
We just have to know it's there.
We just need to know. Is it the Canterbury Tales?
I think it's called The Ribald Tales, R-I-B-A-L-D, The Ribald Tales of Canterbury or something like. Oh, wow. Somebody has already found it.
Oh, wow. Jesus.
Hold on. I'm going to click on Chud Warriors.
Chud Warriors got the Ribald Tales.
I believe this is it.
Oh, yeah. No, 7%. There it is. You can show the 7% rating on there.
I'm trying to figure out how to do that. This whole thing.
Or just pause. Oh, yeah. You can't even show the ads, can you?
The entire thing is just one minefield. Hold on. We can do.
Oh, my God.
Crop that shot, Bryce.
I'm trying.
Dude, hey, can we do similar to how we did? Like, can we?
This is the only portion of this page I can show.
The Ribald Tales of Canterbury.
can we do a commentary track on this? Can the two of us just go through the whole thing and provide a second? Never mind.
I mean, listen, how about this? How about this? If we get to 1,600... by next episode,
yeah,
Brian and I will do some form of commentary.
Mystery on Science Theater Porn 3000.
All right, so there's that. People also point out Killjoys and Boner Killers that Chaucer died in 1400.
Oh, jeez. What a bunch of assholes. Yeah, but the Fatboy Slim remix of all his works happened 150 years later.
Indeed. Brian, do you want to do our favorite part of our Patreon plug?
Oh, my God. Yes, I do. Give me just one moment. Let's see.
So every week, Brian goes through the emails where he gets the notifications about the Patreon.
Oh, man. Holy cow. Somebody made something big happen this morning.
Uh-oh.
I felt a shift.
Uh-huh.
When I realized.
Yeah.
That James Collins.
Collins.
Had pledged $10 an episode.
Collins.
James.
James.
James. James Collins.
James Collins.
James Collins.
James Collins.
James.
James. Collins, 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 Collins.
Hold on. You actually have an echo. You don't need to do your own echo.
Double echo, double echo, double echo.
Thank you. James Collins.
James Collins.
James Collins.
Me amo, James Collins.
Yeah, man, thanks to everybody who's pledged.
I really do love this segment. This is the best.
Can you imagine being that one guy?
Oh, that's awesome.
Imagine if he's also Spanish.
That's a good Spanish name.
And he does say me amo, James Collins?
Yeah.
Hey, Brian.
Yo.
I was watching. Thank you to everybody who came on out to CreateCon.
Yeah,
that was a super blast.
You were watching yourself.
I was watching
them.
That episode.
Oh, it was a good episode, right?
Man, we are funny. A lot of people laughed at us. Like that was. I felt like it was like up on stage. You know, things are going really fast. It's hard to get a gauge of how things are going. You're just trying to have a good time, and in general, you just know it's pretty good if the show seems to fly by, which that one did. But listening to it back, it was like, especially because that room was very forgiving. It was very echoey. So it's like one person laughing sounded like a million. And so the room laughing was just thunderous.
Sure.
Probably the biggest thing from that episode, I think without question, was a little discovery that was made by Chat Realm and brought to us. And we debuted there on the show, right?
Yeah. Okay, look, we found gold. Golden locks on the head of Jennifer Murphy. We definitely this blonde firebrand and her finally speaking truth to power about the ninja cabal and how she's going to break through and become a ninja.
That Chinese ninja cabal led by the villainous Chow, who needs to be chopped down to Chinatown.
That's right. Okay, so that video, we found it, and like 2 days later, it was pulled by her. And what?
Yeah. And she had a little explanation.
Oh, she did?
No, you were saying that like there was some sort of like, hey, this got out of hand.
Oh, yeah. She made a letter that she posted on her website saying like, hey, man, it was a silly video. Got to take it wrong. I'm not about that. And then,
by the way, we have, again, not new to this. We have seen a lot of these videos. We've been, I don't know if lucky's the best word for it, but like we've uncovered a lot of these videos. We've shown them. We've given them a wider audience. And this is about the normal pattern of when things that are embarrassing blow up for people. They take it down or they embrace it. She seemed to take it down. Brian, case closed.
You would think so.
Yep, case closed. She took down the video, Brian.
She
made her statement. We're done with it. Listen, it's not like she's a certain presidential candidate that's going to keep talking about it and keeping it in the news.
She kind of, sort of released another video that's possibly even worse.
I'm sure this video right here, we probably don't even have to watch it. It's probably just a video where she explains what happened. Probably even has that one lady that was next to her to say like, oh no, that's not racist. That's just a thing that it's an inside joke, you know, with our company.
You know what? Let's find out. Let's find out.
Oh, Jesus.
You guys, it's time.
It's time to meet Chow, is what it says.
It all started pretty simple. I mean, I was driving home after a long day. Little did I realize that Chow was staked outside my house.
All right. All right, get ready. Just brace yourselves. Go for it.
Escalate.
And by the way, real quick, let's verify the post date here. You can see
July 28, 2016.
After the whole first episode thing. This is her after apologizing and saying that's not what we're about. So
she apologizes. This video, for those listening on audio, is crudely yet not without effort. Would that be a way to say it?
Like, yes.
Somebody spent amateurs spent a lot of time working on it.
Yes. Here we go. All right. So what we're looking at now is we see a vaguely Asian man
staking out her house.
Wait, hold on. No. Go play that. Play what Chow said.
Staked outside my house in an Escalade.
She has no clue what's coming.
All right. If you are only an audio listener, what you need to understand is that despite the
Hold
fact
on,
that.
Time out. He's picking the locks with
chopsticks. Despite the fact that you were able to understand what Chow was saying, there were also subtitles as if it were so hard to hear. Then what happens, Brian?
Then he walks up and he takes chopsticks to ostensibly pick the lock, but and then drops them to enter the house
of a door
permission.
That is visibly open is cracked.
I mean, that's
beyond
fine.
Cracked.
I'm sure that's part of the aesthetic they were actually going for, along with a copyright free version of the Mission Impossible theme.
Vile says, good start to this porn. All right, we can skip around a little bit here, right?
Yeah, she takes a long... she does make, like, blonde jokes. She's reading a book, like, Big Words for Blondes, and it has words like dog, it, cow, cat.
Chow steals the Murphy bed.
Patent, yeah.
And then she tries to go after him. I mean, really, Brian, is the biggest thing... The fact that this is fairly affluent.
Hold on. Back it up, because here's the best part. At some point, she randomly cuts over to a react video of two YouTubers reacting to her video. Now, these two YouTubers, if you're not familiar with the brouhaha in the react scene, is that there's a number of people calling what they do react videos, but really all they do is they repost somebody else's video, and then they just put themselves in a corner watching it, not talking, and basically they're view jacking. What do they call that? Where anyway.
Freebooting or whatever, yeah.
Freebooting, yeah. But these guys, I've watched their whole commentary video. They do a very good job. They don't show a single frame of her work. They instead just comment. She grabbed the clips.
Well, no, wait,
of them.
Brian, I haven't seen this. I'm sure they're giving a favorable understanding review of that video.
Let's look.
Why would she put it in another video?
Let's take a look.
From Murphy Betts.
Guys, make sure to watch this whole video because we've got a lot to say about this. We've got a lot to say.
Sneak peek.
And then she posts the video. Although it does look like she edits out most of the hero of the video.
Yeah, she definitely edited around the Asian woman, but they've also added these like training montage clips.
And then, and yet again, promises that the for real video is coming soon. Oh, there she is. Back when she was smiling before. Before she heard the rest of it. I get the phone call. I gotta help them all. Go girl will save the day. Child will not get away. It didn't take me long. You can't edit her out.
No. So wait, so this is edited in a new version
using primarily the same footage of the one that she pulled down. Like, all that's different is that they've edited any time they prominently showed the offended Asian princess. She's just edited those out for silly moments.
So, no, she's now in a training montage. How would you describe her ninja trainer?
White. He's very white.
It must have been the part of a actually lesser known a prefect of Japan known as Norway.
He kind of looks like you when you did that.
That's fine. Yeah, yes, he looks like me. That's sure. Yeah. So then, what follows is essentially the same. Everything that was implied is now explicit. How about that?
So here's what I find the most interesting about this version of the video. Can we go to the end?
Sure.
Because after the entire song, which we ran through in, you know, this is, she plays.
Oh, yeah. No, that's it. I think we just ran past it there. I think if you go back about a minute there, Bryce.
I snuck up to his place.
This is a minute.
Opened my ninja case, pulled out my ninja gear.
She plays almost the entire reaction video from the guys that we had mentioned at the beginning.
Why are you going to Chinatown? Go to Japantown.
Go to Japantown.
Why are you going to Chinatown? Jennifer?
Yeah, why'd be like, what? Why don't you
We're
be
not
like,
ninjas? You could be like, you know, you want to be like a. Like a wandering wushu master.
Yeah, or you could pretend you're Japanese instead of Chinese.
It's the other
right.
Asian looking people. Let's bring up another point. What does this have to do with bets?
Absolutely nothing.
I guess ninjas sleep on beds. That's your only connection there. Ninjas, I assume they sleep on beds, or maybe they
All right,
sleep
and so,
on
and
like,
so,
like,
there's
like
no, I guess that's the weird part, is this is not a rebuttal to them. This is just trying to amplify their message about what poor taste, poorly thought out this was? Question mark?
I mean, so many questions, bro.
Why haven't you called her for an interview? I know, I feel the same way.
So wait, Neurotic Hamster asked a question that, so you've watched the entire video that the react guys did, like those are real react guys.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's what they do, is they take something that everybody's watching and they talk about it for 10 minutes. Shockingly close to our show, only much more efficient and more Asian
and more popular, right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
So effectively, all right, let me see if I get this right. She makes this video deemed near universally by the wider internet community as a hilarious white privilege racism on parade, right?
Whoopsie. Sure.
Okay. Pulls it down. Says, hey, you want to know what? Internal thing. It was a joke inside. Probably wouldn't get it from the outside. Apologize for it. Bleep, blop, bloop. We're done with it. Then reposts the song in its entirety,
yep,
with no changes, with enhancements, with the fact that now Chow is not just a random Asian name, but a actual Asian stereotype, doing Asian stereotype things like having subtitles under his words,
even when he's chopsticks, speaking, yes, perfectly fine English, yeah.
Having being foiled by a white person who masters this century-old art in 5 minutes, and then actually violates the copyright of the people who made a react video to her video by playing their stuff ostensibly, at least for all we know, without permission of the guys who made the original react video.
Yes. However, as Orison points out in the chat room, still better than Fantastic Four.
Well, there we go. So at least there's that. At least there's that.
You know, I don't know. I think I see the point here because, like, we've been talking about, like, moving stuff around and, like, you know, making a better guest room. And Brian says, oh, tell me we can get a Murphy bed.
From Jennifer Murphy beds.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God. Somebody just point out, God damn it, in the chat, a little bit distracted. We had some talk earlier on about fleshlights. Turns out there's a fantasy football.
Which, yeah.
I do believe that would pass for a football better than the fleshlight would pass for a flashlight.
Do you think you could sneak that one in for a few snaps in an NFL game and then nobody would notice?
I think so.
You know, if I had one of those husbands that disappears into football, I'd just hand him that and be like, bye.
Hey, I got a little discovery I made on Sunday on the jury show.
Uh-oh. What you got?
I, you know, was reading this New York Times article because I was making fun of it because I thought that it was stupid.
Mm-hmm.
It was, hopefully somebody can find the article there in the chat room. But it was about marriages being threatened by the election. This is obviously a very contentious election, right?
What? Wait, the marriage being between Trump and his current wife? Is that the only one?
I mean, yeah. Who knows? But it is certainly the main lead, right? Is a man and his wife, been married for 20 years, right? They are currently embroiled in a situation where she says if he votes for Trump, as he has told her he would, they are immediately going to get divorced and she's going to move to Canada.
Okay, well, that's a lie. She won't do that.
Well, listen, she says, this is the lead of the article. I'm going to read it for you here right now. If you vote for Trump, I'll divorce you and move to Canada. He tried to laugh it off. She said, I'm serious.
I
heard Canada built a wall.
Hold on, time out. Like, this is, like, okay, if, I'm going to say yes, if all of the country tied and they said, there's only one vote left to cast, and it's your husband. What he does will determine the next 4 years. Then, yes, you know, like, but his vote will not matter in the least. Why would she divorce him
and move to Canada? She'd be canceling it out, right? Like, if she votes for Hillary and he votes for Trump, then effectively they're just evening it out, right? Like, right. She is nullifying his vote.
I mean, I don't know what their relationship is like, but if they're that close that a vote that does not matter in an election that is already a hilarious joke anyway is the straw that she wants or the hill that she wants to die on, I'm going to say maybe it's not the election that's their problem.
So apparently this is brewing, though, right? Dr. McGuire, 59, and her husband, 74, have disagreed over politics before, but never like this. During the 2012 presidential campaign, they had two signs planted side by side on their front lawn in Belmont, Massachusetts, one for her choice, Barack Obama, and the others for his, Mitt Romney. We go to a quote from the husband. Politics were very low on the list of priorities when we met, said Dr. Thomas Stossel, whose political ideology was made a rightward turn in the 1980s, bringing him more in line with his brother.
No!
Gosh, you just floored me. I was like, wait a minute.
What?
That name?
Inception button.
Oh my gosh.
Therapists say, which now we can just, assuming they have the same voice, therapists say you have the best relationship when you're clearly separate people. And I like to think that we're emotionally centered so that we can have a major disagreement about something and it's not a big problem.
Wow.
Dude, I literally was in the middle of just reading this because I just thought it was a stupid article and it was dumb.
Oh my gosh. Like,
my whole point was that the New York Times will do these trend pieces, right? And here's what you need for a trend piece. Three examples. You can find anything can be a trend in general. But the New York Times is really bad with it because they usually keep it to New York. So just find three people in Manhattan that are into slap bracelets, and now all across in the newspaper of record.
The hottest trend among Manhattanites. Yeah.
Wait, people getting their hair caught in bunchums.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. You were number three in that.
I was.
But at least for that, they then went to like other documented like message boards and stuff like that. They could back it up to make it show that it's a larger thing. Can you think of something more out of touch that the New York Times could do than, all right, here's some asinine article about how, hey, couples are fighting about this election. Like, A, it's the dumbest article you could possibly think of writing.
Right.
But then to give it grounding, you're like, oh, man, we got to have a good just meat and potatoes example of how this is affecting the nation. Oh, I know. Let's talk to the both of them are professors at either Harvard or another Massachusetts institution, and one of them is the brother of John Stossel. That is the headline. The headline is John Stossel's brother might get divorced because of this election.
Well, okay,
that's all you need to write.
Well, and that's the funny part is that they, I mean, talk about burying the lead. Are you kidding me? Like just a little side note in there. By the way, his brother is John Stossel.
I was reading it, and I'm like in early May when Dr. Thomas Stossel? Like, I was like, oh, look, it's funny. Look, I like whenever I see the word Stossel, I do the Stossel voice.
Yeah.
Then it came like later in the article. It was just like, oh, my God, this is really happening.
That's amazing. Dude, that is amazing.
Wow.
A lot of people think my sister-in-law's kind of a bitch. She brings up hot issues that don't need to be so dramatic.
But also, let's talk about my brother being an asshole. He used to give me noogies and said it's okay because I wasn't matching his family values. That's why I became a libertarian.
In fact, they kind of deserve each other. My co-host Barbara Walters agreed after a chance encounter in the lobby of the studio.
James Randi says he'll give $1 million if their marriage lasts another week.
Oh, my God. Well, docile.
The thing is.
Yeah.
Like, she doesn't get to know if he voted for her or not. Yeah, for him.
It's a secret vote.
For her.
Well, that's the other thing we were saying. Yeah. Is that like, so what? Would you rather him lie and just say, oh, no, baby, don't worry. I'm voting for Hillary. And then he walks into the booth and votes for Trump anyway? Like it just seems like such a dumb thing to even argue about as a couple.
I mean, that's actually his one play is the Schrodinger's vote. Where he just like he just never admits what he voted. Like, you know, he could be wearing a Trump shirt and a Trump hat, smoking on a Trump pipe, wearing his hair in a faux Trump pompadour, and then she's like, "Well, tell me, who did you vote for? Because otherwise, these immigration papers aren't going to sign themselves, and I also have these divorce papers to sign. Who did you vote for?" And he just puffs twice, blows a smoke ring in her face, and says, "I don't know." It's a secret.
So, you know, the way I picture it.
And then he blows out a big smoke like
the SHHH.
Dot 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 dot.
The way I picture it is this like 70s cartoon that's just a kind of a trippy dude that's just white drawing on a colored background and goes, "The world will never know."
Wait, oh, are you? Wait, is that a reference to the Tootsie Roll ads?
Yeah.
Wow, that was a deep cut, Mon. To a candy ad from our childhood.
I'm sorry.
No, it was good. It was good.
Oh my God! Hey, wait. By the way, so I didn't even get later into this interview. Like this lady who wrote this article, what's her name? I don't know. Aswerdahar Papu, is stirring up crap with the Stossels.
How look, so?
When asked about Mr. Trump's talk of building a wall in the United States border, blah, 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 Dr. Stossel says nice things about Trump. And then in a separate interview later that afternoon, Dr. McGuire seemed unaware of her husband's stance. She sounded confident that Dr. Stossel had been dissuaded from his support by friends, as well as her quasi-threat to leave him.
Quasi-threat? Well, what's quasi about the explicit threat of I will divorce you and move to Canada? How is that a quasi-threat?
When told by this reporter of her husband's intent to go through with voting for Trump, she seemed shocked, if not angry. "That's news to me," John Stossel's sister-in-law says. "I'll be calling my attorney."
My attorney!
Let me tell you, yeah, I know how this story came about. They're all at the bridge game. They've had a few drinks. And then she leans over and says, "Oh, yeah, we had this argument." Because they're in the Northeast. "We had this argument. And like, I'm totally leaving him if he votes for Trump."
More like Bunko, people are saying. Was it a Bunko?
Oh, you think it was Bunko? It was probably Bunko. Yeah. I can't even
remember. Hold on. Wait a minute. No. We just... New character alert.
Yeah, dude. Bonnie's Northeasterner. The Nor'easter.
Yeah. Wait. So, Bonnie, what is this Northeastern character's name?
Angela. Wait, is that anybody we know? Is anybody we know?
Oh,
Angela?
It's fine. Where did Angela go to school?
Oh, she went to a really high-powered school, and she's still paying off her debt because they're all like private schools up there. You might need to tell me one because
Brown,
I knew Brown. Passer. She went to Brown.
Okay.
She did.
All right. And what does Angela do for a living nowadays?
Oh, no, she doesn't.
She doesn't know what she does.
Well, she likes to play tennis and bunko, and you know, her husband, he works a lot, so she's really there for him.
Have you ever met John Stossel?
Oh yeah, the guy's a real dick.
Oh yeah.
Oh, John Stossel. No, I was talking about his brother. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Well, your husband.
Oh wait. Oh.
Oh no.
I thought it was the reporter there for a little bit. I got all confused.
Oh, fine. No, Bonnie, you're going in and just explore the room.
Keep going, girl. Keep going.
Okay. All right. So Angela on a work trip is sent down to Texas. What does she think about Texas?
Oh, it's so god awful hot there. And then everybody's just wearing their hats like for real, but they're not cowboy hats. They're just like douchebag hats. They're douchebag hats with tractor signs on them. I really hated it.
douchebag hats with tractor signs.
Yes.
Was there anything good? Good about Texas? Do you like anything about Texas?
Yeah, they had this like really fantastic place where you could get tacos.
Oh, what was it?
The tacos were really good.
What was it?
It's called Torchy's Tacos.
Oh, you're just actually going to give a plug to a local Austin chain of tacos.
I'm just like...
I hope they're listening right now. And I hope they give my friend, Bonnie Brushwood, free tacos next time she shows up.
Torchy's, I love you.
Do they let you play Bunko there?
Oh, no. But we did have a couple of martinis that we snuck in a thermos.
What? You snuck in martinis?
Yeah, that's a little ratchet, Angela. I didn't know y'all got down like that at Brown.
Oh, you know, you gotta do all that. Yeah, Daddy doesn't like it when I sneak my
How old are you, Angela?
Oh, you know, I'm 35.
Well, there we go, ladies and gentlemen. Angela from the Northeast. Angela, any party words here? Anything you'd like to leave our show with now that you are returning to the Northeast from whence you came?
Oh, you know, I just kind of made all that shit up about the sausals. They're really great.
Also, I needed a story. Everybody vote for Gary Johnson. He's the only really
Gary Johnson.
Cat.
You know, he has some real experience.
There we go. Angela from the Northeast, of the Connecticut, the famous Connecticut Angelas.
Did I hear right? Did Angela just win the belt?
The characters can't win the belt.
Yeah. BS. By the way, I'm playing a character called Shadow Brian. I'm only just now showing up as actual Brian. Up until now, it's been Shadow Brian the entire show long.
Has Captain Morgan ever paid a
belt? No, and the Morgans ever won the belt. That's why we had to have the no character belt rule.
Well, I'll tell that to Shadow Brian. Shadow Brian.
Oh, Shadow Brian. Wow, this is Character Corner. Shadow Brian, how have you enjoyed the Nether Realm?
It's been a real trip, let me tell you.
Wow, Shadow Brian, it seems like you would really only be invented so you can curse, but you haven't cursed at all.
That's because the system's rigged against people who curse, and I'm not willing to participate. The only way to throw away your vote is to vote. I'm Shadow Brian.
Wow, Shadow Brian, what do you have anything else to say about the world at large?
I don't like... Sorry, I was just going to say something terrible. I don't like that minority that you like. I'm Shadow Brian.
Angela from the Northeast? I don't think she's a minority.
I like that Shadow Brian has an inherent goatee.
All right, now you're just making noises, Shadow Brian. I mean, if you're going to be on the show, you should probably say something.
I say... Wait, we can't talk about the movie draft minute because there are no more movie draft minutes. I'm Shadow Brian.
Would you like to do Diamond Time?
Yes, I would.
All right, Diamond Time is where you can shout out your project right here on the show. Just head on over to diamondclub.reddit.com. Again, that is diamondclub.reddit.com. The big sticky green text at the top of the page is where you can shout out your projects. Let's go ahead and start off. This is a big one here, folks. JF Dubois. Greetings, you wonderful bunch of attractive misfits. DragonCon. I really want to go to that place. I want to see Night Attack and all the strange cosplay, and I want to get drunk with Diamond Club. I want to go where all the cool kids go. And this year, you see, I might make it there because I have some serious extra incentive in what I am sure will be revealed to be a clerical error. My science fiction book, The Life Engineered, has been nominated for a Dragon Award.
Woo!
First ever Dragon Awards, by the way, that especially because the Hugos have kind of been in this weird controversial place. It's a very important year for this award, and he's nominated. Other nominees in this category include Kim Stanley Robinson and Anne Leckie. I'm going to lose, obviously, but wouldn't it be neat if I got to give the winner a solid run for their money? Like, maybe if this was a popular vote award, like the podcast awards, and I got some help. Snap! It totally is! So if you want to upset the system a little, and maybe you can by visiting bit.ly/dragonrobot to participate. You'll fill out the form and eventually be sent a survey. Just make sure you pick The Life Engineered in the Science Fiction category. Oh, thanks, Powerful Diamond Club. See you at DragonCon, JF Dubois.
Dude, now, JF Dubois is one of the good ones. I certainly would love for him to give a run for his money. However, having said that, Kim Stanley Robinson wrote a damn fine novel with the one that's up. Is it Aurora? What is it? Yeah, damn it.
I don't know, because I don't give a rat's ass, because Kip Stanley Robinson ain't my friend.
Yeah, no, that's right. Yeah, screw that, KSM.
Listen, I mean, he's going to win a million awards. All right, so real quick backstory on JF. This was, I believe, the first book that was put out on the Sword and Laser imprint.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's right.
He's been on Weird Things. He's a friend of the show. I was very, very excited to see him on that list and texted him immediately about it. This is just super rad. So, of course, big disclaimer, if you've not read at least enough of the nominees to have an opinion, then you don't have to vote, but it is out there. JF Dubose, The Life Engineered, is where you need to give your support.
Yeah, man. Sorry, I was ready to read, and then somebody tweeted me a picture of Shadowbriar. He's a terrifying beast. Adventure Agreed writes, warning, read with a serious tone. Hello, Diamond Club. A few weeks ago, the village I live in was attacked by some local raiders. A few people were killed, and a lot of our valuables were stolen. The rest of us are okay. Can you find some music to lay underneath this? I just want to give it the proper gravitas as we do this.
Sure.
The rest of us are okay and have since had most of our belongings recovered. That's where we would like your help. Our village is safe now because of a group of adventurers who came to our aid and cleared the evil gnolls out of the cave. We would ask the Diamond Club to, in turn, show them a little support. Adventure Incorporated is a Dungeons & Dragons comedy adventure podcast. Six friends who used to be in a college improv comedy troupe now play Dungeons & Dragons and recorded. If you like fantasy stories with a twisting, long-form narrative and fun characters with deep personal story arcs and interesting interactions, then head on over to bit.ly/YOLOAdventure420 and check out the podcast. If you like it, do all those things people do for podcasts. We'd like those things. Thanks, guys. Anthony. Agreed, when I am very rarely in the chat room.
And Snappier writes, hello, you beautiful group of diamonds. My friend Tom Tran is finally taking podcasting seriously, and I wanted to share his efforts with you. His podcast is called Sex, Jokes, and Rock and Roll and should be entertaining to many of you. Tom is a professional comedian and also the traffic guy on KNX in Los Angeles. He and I served in Iraq together. While there, he got shot in the head. Jesus.
Whoa.
After dealing with the recovery, I mean, geez, you know, Bryce, can we get some music for this?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Let's put it in a proper context, for crying out loud.
I mean, Jesus, come on. After dealing with the recovery, he used comedy as a way to help out over the deep, dark pit of PTSD. Luckily, he's going great now and has this show for you to enjoy. You can find the podcast at sexjokesrock.com or yolo420.com/1A. Hey, listen, we wouldn't do that if he wasn't a comedian.
I mean, what would we do if he was a dentist? Everything the same, but he was a dentist.
Then,
Do we play the sad piano music?
Well, yeah.
Never forget.
The Shadow Demon would read the... all right, so if you would like to get your project shouted out, then go ahead and hit us up on Diamond Dime. That is reddit.com/r/diamondclub or diamondclub.reddit.com. Thank you to everybody. We always read the top three, but we very much encourage everybody to read all of them. There's always great, great, great things on that. It is the highlight of our subreddit. Brian?
Yeah, buddy.
We don't have an official movie draft minute, but let's
unofficially talk about how tight, like man's anus this is. This is going to be a tight race. Like, yeah. Shadow Brian is the one doing that. I would never do that. Shadow Brian is all like, yeah. No. Yeah, man. We had a behind the scenes discussion. For some reason, I don't think you were copied on that, Justin. Tom reached out to the commissioner, Dan Dirks, to verify the last day because, Movie League Mike, writer of the Crumdom, said, hey, it looks like literally one day will matter on determining the winner. He said that, that we have to verify the last date. And so it's verified as the Thursday 4 weeks after the launch of the last movie. So it technically the script ends on Friday, but it locks in whatever the values are. But Friday doesn't report until Saturday or Sunday. So basically all the money as of Thursday, September 1st, it technically ends on Friday, September 2nd. But like, man, this stuff is real. It's happening.
So what's your gut?
We're screwed. I think we're screwed. So, well, so here's the question. Has there been anything that is taken away the kids' vote from Secret Life of Pets? I feel like it's got maybe 5 or 10 million left in the tank.
There's like a Zubo Jubo with two strings or something coming out that I saw this week.
Zubo Jubo.
Abzo? Is that it?
It's something Z. Z Zohan with two strings. Zubo with two strings.
Right on. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. Kubo. Kubo. K-U-B-O.
Oh, yeah. It kind of looks like a drunk Z.
Yeah. 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 That's one where like somebody has to learn to rock, right?
I don't know, man. It's like Asian or something. So,
I want to be a musician.
So yeah. What did Ghostbusters and Secret Life of Pets make this week?
I don't know. I bet if we went to Box Office Mojo, we could find it.
I think we basically have what, a $40 million cushion?
But again, that's under assault. Like that stuff is still
pouring
in.
But just so people understand the stakes here.
Yeah, it's shockingly close, and we've got
like $48 million cushion. And then we have whatever is petering out of, Secret Life of Pets this weekend made $10 million.
So it's still making money. All right, no, that makes me feel
Ghostbusters
better.
Ghostbusters is
out. It's not making
dunzo,
cash.
Right?
Yeah. Star Trek Beyond made 6.9. Suicide Squad made 43 over the weekend.
Is Pete's Dragon out?
Yeah,
but,
Pete's Dragon is out.
The good news on Suicide Squad is that it fell a monstrous like 70% from.
Yeah, I don't know. If I was doing a side bet, I'd say we're gonna lose, which is a bummer.
You know, the kids
because
are
if that
college.
Fell, I mean, because that's really what I've come to learn. The crumdum is really what you are looking at is you're not only guessing projections for how it launches, but you're guessing holds. You're guessing percentages of what it drops.
Right, right.
And that's when he factors everything in, he's factoring in that not only will a certain movie behave like it's predecessors or like-minded movies in terms of how much it grosses, but also how fast it drops. And that's why he initially thought that it was going to be, despite the fact that it looked like we were toast, that the only thing that was giving us hope was that they, if this behaves like Batman vs Superman, which it did, and starts dropping like a stone, that it's not going to have the same kind of holding power that something that launched at the number that it did would.
Yeah, I got to tell you, the momentum, I mean, just, I don't think we can, if they have one more weekend, even close to what they're doing now, I think they're going to overtake
it. So says if it drops 50% each weekend, it nets another 33.
Right, exactly. And
right
and
now, Secret Life of Pets is outgrossing what Star Trek Beyond is. So if it gets 33 million, then we win.
Yeah, I guess we'll see. I don't know. I'm not so optimistic.
Kids are going back to school
yeah,
soon.
I don't know.
Bonnie says kids are going back to school, which I don't know if that's a veiled threat about how I need to win so that we can pay for school.
No.
Are you saying that they're...
No, I'm saying the viewership's going to drop off. It's at the end of the summer. Everybody's doing a movie. And then the kids are all going to go back to school very soon. And they won't be watching movies.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Fine. Well, sorry. I guess we're going to find out in these next 2 weeks, though. But this is close as it's been in a while, right? There was that one summer with Lincoln, right?
Yep. Lincoln, that was a winter. And, in fact, I was screwed up until the point that Lincoln got nominated for like 12 Academy Awards or something insane. And then all of a sudden,
everybody went to go back to see, like,
all of a sudden it got that big bump, right? And then, and it was only, I was in the Tom role where it's like, if I just had more time, I would be safer. But it ended up, we barely eked our way across the finish line.
Oh, damn. awesome, man. Well, I'm pumped, man. This is proven to be a pretty rad. Although nobody will get to a billion.
Yeah, which is surprising. But then again, this has been a weird, disappointing box office draw, you know, summer altogether, right?
Yeah. No, definitely. I mean, like, there was like the few big ones, but I mean, this was definitely, I guess, the lesson of this draft was like you do. Well, you know, Costco Tom, man. Costco Tom really hit big with the Jungle Book. And then, man, his sampler platter. His sampler platter was enough to...
Old sampler platter. Yeah.
Yeah, because look at this. There is not an earner amongst his little sloppy ass slate, except for Suicide Squad.
Kill
meanwhile, look at us. Balling out of control with Captain America and the Secret Life of Pets. If only that Ghostbusters movie wasn't so mediocre.
So mediocre. Are you watching the Olympics at all?
I mean, a little bit. I never know when to put it on, and I never know when people are like, people are always bitching about, like, on the West Coast about how it's tape delayed and everything, and I don't know where to watch it live. Like, it's just a pain in the butt. What, are you watching a lot?
I my uncle was, and we were on vacation, and so he kept turning it on, and, you know, they would explain to us the story. Like, it's like they knew the story ahead of the race. They're all like, listen, this one guy named Mo is going to trip and fall, but then he's going to come back, and those mean old Kenyans are going to try to stop him from getting ahead of him, but he's going to run around the Kenyans, and he'll win the gold anyway. Watch. And
how did they do that? That's amazing.
What, the Kenyans?
No, how did they know ahead of time?
Oh, because it was tape delayed. It was.
Oh, that's their trick.
Bonnie was like making cash bets. Like, hell no, $50. It doesn't happen like that.
But Bonnie, like it happens. And Bonnie's like, rewind that DVR. She rewinds it. She goes, I'll go double or nothing. He's gonna make it this time.
Now, what really cracked me up is. Brian's aunt kept going, oh yeah, she's just gorgeous. Just look at her. She's like, you know, she was like evaluating all the physiques.
I mean, isn't that why everybody, I mean, you watch the Olympics to see human beings at the peak of athleticism.
Yeah,
like, they are perfect beings.
I watched women's weightlifting.
Okay.
Okay.
Diesel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, I wasn't sure what I was looking at.
All right. Jeez. No body shaming. No,
that's raw power, baby.
I'm just saying.
Putting up that weight. Sorry. They're their, you know, one-way ticket to Gainesville.
Yeah. No, I just feel like these people, like, worked really hard to be, like, really good at something, and they're still getting evaluated on their looks. I don't think that's why they signed up.
But, like, their one girl had really pretty hair. She dyed it in the colors of Jamaica's flag.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah.
That was really cool. Mm.
All right, so...
Oh, by the way, funny line that was said. Yeah, runs around those mean old Kenyans like Obama. Anyway.
Oh my gosh.
Just saying, it's your uncle, man. That's a weird thing to say.
Oh, I feel like we learned a lot, Justin.
We learned time zones.
We learned that characters don't ever get the belt, which is why Shadow Brian will be standing in for regular Brian.
Shadow Brian didn't curse.
I mean, whatever curses happened, it happened while I was pretending to be him.
Can't wait until we have to do Shadow Brian live. Shadow Brian's going to be the most popular character, and it's just going to lead to you smearing paint on your face.
Oh, do me a favor, guys. Die in a fire.
See you next Tuesday.
Justin Robert Young. Every time you go, I get so sad. that I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack, 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 night attack. I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
I had to do it on my phone because Winamp crashed.